Once I knew Liverpool were involved, it was like, that's where I'm going. Gerard was fantastic. Always took a lot of the pressure off being that father figure for you.
Do you have a favourite Liverpool moment?
The FA Cup. Winning that was just an amazing feeling.
Emile Heskey, our latest guest on We Are Liverpool. Great to see you.
Thank you.
You're very familiar with this place as well because you were spending so many years driving your kids here for the academy.
Yeah, but obviously over that side. But yeah, my two boys used to come here when they were very, very young.
That's part of your life now, isn't it?
Driving.
Your two boys. You are the taxi driver for them as well. Is it a funny existence that once you've been in football, indoctrinated into it every day, being told when to be there, what time to be away, now you're living the life again, but through your boys?
Yeah, it's a little bit weird, obviously now, but I see it from the other side where as a player, you're getting up and you're making sure that you're here at this time. Now I'm making sure that they're there at that time. They've got this and they've got that, they've packed that. And then just sitting there waiting for them to come back out and taking them home again. So yeah, it's a little bit different, but I'm enjoying the little journey that they're on.
Very good footballers as well there at Manchester City.
They're doing okay. They're doing 18s. Well. Yeah, they're doing really well.
How difficult is that role then between being someone who's lived that life to an elite level and just being their dad?
I tried to just be their dad. The thing with parents in at times, you know, you want to tell them what to do and they've got to do it. So if I tell them what to do and they've got to do it, is that a conflict in coaching? So I tend to just sit back and wait for them to come and ask the question and I'll give my view. I'll probably watch some stuff back and say, have you ever thought about doing this? What do you think of that? Blah, blah, blah. But I won't directly say, come on, you've got to do this. No, they've got the coach to do that and they've done all right so far.
It's a difficult life that though, isn't it? As a parent, sometimes I think taking a back seat when you know so many of the traps they might just fall into.
Yeah, I think when you're talking about traps, again, playing side of traps is a little bit different to the off-field kind of thing. You can see the off-field kind of things and you could probably manipulate that a little bit more. But when you're talking about playing, I think you have a team that plays a certain way. They've already shown him how they want him to play, so let him go and let them go and do that.
But they're in good hands, aren't they?
Oh, yeah.
What you're saying, isn't it? You don't need to interfere.
No, I don't. And again, I sit down with them sometimes, especially the eldest one, and I asked him a question. And it was a while back, to be fair. So I asked him about when they're playing out, how do you defend? I said, and he just went into this one big hoo-ha about if they play out with a three, this is how we go. Someone's got to jump in and do this and blah. I'm like, okay, what if they're playing out with a four? If they're playing out with a four, two got to jump in and then we match them up. What if they're just playing out with the goalkeeper and he comes in? Well, this is what we do. He had an answer for everything.
Yeah, yeah.
Whereas the reality is, when I was playing, you're kind of figuring it out on the pitch at times. Yeah. But he had the answer, and they're very clever in everything that they've got.
So what are they like if we compare them to daddy?
Totally different. In the sense of, I'll give you the example. So I put on a post actually recently, and he knows a lot more than me when I was playing at that age. So if you're looking at 18, to me 18, even though I was playing first team football, I've got an adult's body, but my knowledge is not quite what he's got. But I figured things out very quickly. Whereas he's got all the knowledge now already, but he probably hasn't got the adult body that I had. That I can go and play and have no fear, but I think he's coming into that now. But his football brain is a lot quicker than mine.
Are they supportive of each other because they're quite often playing in the same team, aren't they?
Yeah, they have to be, but they're totally different positions. So one's more of a winger; he can play at number nine. The younger one's more of a winger, and the elder one's a number nine, but actually plays number eight really well. Like I said, we talk about knowledge of football. He does exactly what a coach wants of him. And that was a funny thing when playing when he was younger. So they used to, especially when they got to cup finals, wherever the threat was, Jaden will play there. Because they know that he will nullify that threat. And he just did it. And now he's getting to a point where he understands every single position, which is great.
Let's talk about your career then.
Mm-hmm.
They all started at Leicester City. How did that all come about? I mean, when did you join?
Joined Leicester at nine. It's funny because back then you'd play Sunday League football and then you'd be spotted by scouts at Sunday League football, but I never played Sunday League football until I'd already been at Leicester. So I played for the school team. Sunday was more for church. And then I went from the school team to Leicester City, played there. And one of the parents asked me to come and play Sunday League football. I said, well, I'll play football. But you have to ask my mum and dad. So they went to ask my mum and dad, and they said, yeah. And that's how I got into Sunday League football. But from nine all the way onwards. So from nine, you're playing. Back then, it was called Centre of Excellence. So you have 50, 60 kids running around mad. But then as the years go on, it gets whittled down to smaller groups, really intense learning. And yeah, I just kept going through that procedure. And I was playing under-18s football at 15. And obviously, when you leave school, that's when you can actually sign. So I was... left school at 16, signed. I was actually training with the first team then. Played a pre-season game, got injured, but then went back with the youth team for about 3 months, and then went with the first team again, and then made my debut in March 95, I'm showing my age.
As a young boy, eh?
17, just turned.
People think back to those teams, don't they? The famous cup runs, you know, some real old school professionals then. How did they take you on board?
They were fantastic, brilliant. We had some really, really good characters, and that was one of the things that Martin O'Neill did really well, brought the real good characters together. Because when you look at it, we really shouldn't have been doing what we were doing. So we went to 97, 99, 2000. League Cup finals. So three in 4 years, when you come up into the Premier League, they're saying you're going to get relegated. And that's the thing. But you're saying, oh, yeah, you're going to get relegated. We went to the cup final and stayed in the top half of the table and kind of made it our own in that sense.
You mentioned Martin O'Neill. I mean, he's done a good job almost everywhere he's been. What did he have?
I think he had this belief in himself and a belief in others and made others feel that they were the best in their positions. You got a Steve Walsh who I watched when I was a kid, and then I play him with him, and he's still one of the best players. And he can play up front, he can play at the back, he can play anywhere. Then goes and buys Matty Elliott. No one really knows anything about him in that sense, and then he becomes an integral part of that team and an international, Scotland international. Muzzy, is it? Playing in the reserves for Chelsea. No one even knows who he is. I thought he was just someone's mate. And then he becomes an integral part of the reason we got up into the Premier League. And then becomes a Turkish international and goes to the semi-final in the World Cup. Mm. Players like that, all these different players that he brings in, and they make such a difference. He had the knack of doing that and making them feel special when they're playing. So believing that they're the best on the pitch.
So you got yourself into the first team at Leicester, yeah. And it's obviously things are going really well. Mm-hmm. And you're being linked with other clubs. What are you thinking at that time? Is there any way you would like to go, or are you not bothered about all the rumours?
I didn't really care about the rumours. I'd been linked with a lot of teams from... Well, I was training with this first team at 16. I'd played with the England under 16, so you kind of know that you're going to be linked with teams. And I'd been linked with teams from about 15, 16. There was an opportunity, not an opportunity, I think someone put a bid in when I was 16, but I didn't really want, I wanted to play for Leicester. That's where I'm from, that's where I was raised, and I wanted to play for them and then establish myself there first and then move on. And then obviously, once I knew Liverpool were involved, it was like, oh, that's where I'm going. So it wasn't a case of, yeah, all these other clubs, and I had Villa, I had Spurs, I had Blackburn, Dortmund. I had a few others as well that were involved, and it was just like once I knew Liverpool were involved, it was like that was it.
I was at Wembley in February 2000, Argentina. I'm not even sure why I was there, but you had some game that day.
Yeah, it was an interesting game. I'll give you a funny story about that. Where was I? I was on a plane somewhere, and an Argentinian journalist who worked for ESPN in London. Bielsa was the manager, wasn't he?
Yeah.
And called him up and says, "What's the team going to be? Give me a bit of information about the team. Give me information about the players. I heard Heskey's going to play. Blah blah blah." And the guy goes, "Nah, he's not playing. He's not going to play. Blah blah blah. No. I've heard he's going to play, and he's this, he's that. Because he's not going to play. Don't worry. He's not going. It's going to be Shearer and Phillips." No, then that's not going to be the team. This is the team. And he goes, no, don't worry, he's not good enough. He's not going to be playing. Blah, blah. I obviously played, and they brought off the captain after 20 minutes, yeah, or yeah, something like that.
I bet he was delighted to get out. He had a hard time, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was tough.
Did Liverpool ever mention that game when they signed you?
No, not in particular, no.
But it was a real breakthrough at the biggest stage, wasn't it?
But the thing was, you say that. So England under 18s, Gerard Houllier was the manager for France. Me and Mike were up front for England. Yeah, so it's gone back even before that. And obviously then I played a game under 18s. I think I was a first year scholar, YTS, and it was, we played Liverpool. So it been something that was in the pipelines for a while.
Kept an eye on you.
Yeah. And then obviously I break through and I become a regular. And then once you start becoming a regular, that's when people are really starting paying attention. And then obviously that game and some other games that I played in as well. So, yeah.
You won the Worthington Cup as well, didn't you, with Leicester? John Aldridge was the manager of Tranmere at the time. There was a bit of speculation then that maybe Liverpool was going to be the club. Did you know then that you were leaving? Or
I kind of knew that I was, but I didn't know when that was all going to transpire. Probably looked at more like the end of the season. But it obviously sped up because I think Liverpool were looking to try and get into the Champions League at the time, and it all sped up, and then that horrid day in Bradford, where we didn't manage to get that win. But yeah, I think I was it was already in the pipelines, and I kind of got it in my mind that I was on my way out, because again, I'd got to a point, especially at Leicester. And look, Leicester's a fantastic club for me, being born and raised there, and then going up into the Premier League. And we were a bit of a yo-yo team, but going up into the Premier League and being established in the Premier League, and not just that, being an established team going to cup finals, I just thought that was fantastic. And it was weird for me that I had that feeling that was the norm. But I was a young kid, so I didn't realise that. And then you come to Liverpool and you go and win 5 trophies and you feel that's the norm.
You come to Liverpool and the quality of the squad around must have just been mind-blowing. Mm. And obviously, like Sir Michael Owen and Robbie Fowler in training. Did you have that time where you just thought, wow, how good are these two?
Always. Obviously, I'd been with the England setup as well, so I'd seen all that. But then when you come here and you're seeing it on a regular basis, two strikers that their finishing is unreal. I always say Robbie's best finisher I've seen. And he was just phenomenal, but Michael as well. Michael had the ability to finish as well. So just working with them on a regular basis was great, because again, you've got to step up your game now as well.
And there was no ability to have a bad day in training, was there?
No, you've got to be on it all the time. And that was good as well. That was key, because if you're not on it 24/7, you can't expect to get to the weekend and turn it on. And that was my thing as well. So I always wanted to train the way I played.
It sounds like Gerard Houllier didn't have to sell you the idea of coming to Liverpool. No. But nevertheless, he must have told you something. He must have gone, listen, this is the reason I'm buying you. This is the plan.
Oh, yeah.
What did he tell you?
But exactly what you said. This is how we want to play. This is how you're going to be the focal point of this. We've got Michael. You already played up front with Michael. You know Robbie from England. You know Jamie Redknapp was there, blah, blah, blah. You know all these players from England. I played with Jamie Carragher. Funny story. So I joined England under 16s, and I was on the bench. Carragher was up front. So, yeah, we knew each other from then. Thomas, Dave Thompson, all these England players, youth players. So I knew a lot of the players from the England youth and playing with England as well. So I kind of had a feeling that this was the place to be, and they're going places.
Can you shut your eyes and remember the phone call or driving to Melwood or Anfield, wherever it was, on the day to sign? How special
Yeah,
that
it was.
Was
it was a weird one, because again, it was just out of the blue kind of thing. Because the reality is, you think, oh yeah, wait till the end of the season, blah blah blah. But then you're suddenly, well, I'm in Liverpool, and it's funny because I'm a young lad. What was I? 22, yeah, and I've never moved before. I barely moved out of my mum and dad's house, and I had like a Puma tracksuit on, and everyone's like, well, why is he turn up with a Puma tracksuit? You should have a suit on. How am I supposed to, though? I didn't get the memo. So little things like that, you kind of remember, and all these flashing lights, and then you realise it's a big deal. It's a big deal coming to a huge club.
So your last game for Leicester, against Sunderland. Mm. Your first game for Liverpool.
Against Sunderland, yeah.
Do you sense there's a difference in Sunderland when they play Leicester compared to when they play Liverpool?
I think everyone.
Yeah.
Yeah, everyone. I'll give you a story of that. So obviously played, and it was like my last game, like you're saying, last game we beat them 5-1 or 5-2. Big Stan Collymore scored 3. I got 1 at Filbert Street. You're like, well, this is a good game, yeah. Then you go and play at Anfield, everyone steps their game up again. I think that was 1-1, Ken Phillips scored the penalty. And then, was it Paddy Berger scored? I think it's Paddy Berger scored the penalty as well. But then, not long before I'd left Leicester, I played in I played against Everton. It was a game of football, yeah, you're thinking, okay. But then I came here, and I'm thinking it's the same Everton that I'm playing. No, it's not. It's not. It's totally different. And that was hard to get my head around. One, because I'm still thinking, well, you're selling people short when you're playing against them. But then two, you realise what it actually means to be playing. One, at Liverpool, and then two, against Liverpool.
There's many players over the years who said it's not easy to be a Liverpool player. And I guess that's what you're telling us, isn't it?
Well, it's not easy to be a footballer.
Yeah.
Because you put pressure on yourself, people put pressure on you, and there's an expectation, not just from you, but from everyone. And then it's not your life, it's everyone's life. Even though you're this person, you're living in within something that is taking over you. So, and then and I spoke about it before, everyone knows how big Liverpool is as a football club. But it's not until you actually come here that you realise how big Liverpool is as a football club. Up to 2001. So imagine football in America. I'm walking down the street being recognised in 2001. Not now, 2001. No one even knew anything about football back then in America, but you still get recognised. Not because of me, it's because of Liverpool Football Club. Because I'd been going to America with Leicester. It wasn't the same. And then you suddenly sign for Liverpool and you're put on this another level of vision.
So how did you cope with all that added pressure living away from home?
The living away from home was the toughest part,
really?
To be honest with you. That was the toughest part. And you know, as you say, living away from home, I'm 2 hours away. I'm not in Australia.
No, but if it's the first time, it's...
But I didn't realise that.
Yeah.
I didn't know that. And the funny thing is, like, you look at it now and you with all that we've got, you've got sat-nav, you've got this, you've got that, you've got delivery, you've got this. You've got everything in the palm of your hand, but I had a map. I just about had a sat-nav back then as well. So, and I remember couldn't get to Melwood because I didn't know where it was. But you have a bit of a meltdown at times because you're like, ooh. But then it helped me grow up, to be honest with you. But it was tough at first. Just you have this thought of how things are going to go, and then you realise that your support mechanism's gone. Well, it's not gone, it's somewhere else. And you've got to grow up. And it was tough at first, very tough.
It's a good insight, that, for us non-players. Mm. You know, this is a 22-year-old boy that comes to the biggest club in the world, as far as...
And I was a boy, and that was the thing. People ask me, say, oh, yeah, when you came to Liverpool, I was only 22 when I actually joined Liverpool. Just turned as well, so I'd only just turned in January. So I was still a boy, even though this made me grow up, and it was actually really good in the end.
Were you homesick then?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, badly. But I didn't know what homesick was because I'd never left my house.
You just felt something wasn't quite right.
Yeah. And it's funny, I questioned whether I'd done the right thing, but then I'd go to training and it would be brilliant. Yeah. It would be amazing. Then I'd come out of the training ground and I'd be like, where am I? But again, it made me grow up quicker.
So you've gone from Martin O'Neill to Gerard Houllier.
Yeah.
Tell us about Gerard.
I'd gone from very little instructions to basically gone from play the way you play, enjoy your football, be yourself, to then being real structured. I'd gone from very rarely having a meeting to a meeting every single day, 45 minutes, walking through to gone from five-a-side footballs to walking through patterns of play. But you know what, I enjoyed both of them. I enjoyed this because it's a lot of information. And when you went on the pitch, it was like, everything just seemed a little bit more clearer and quicker, come to you quicker. So I enjoyed both sides of it. Gerard was fantastic. And all for the players, always took a lot of the pressure off. So media, blah, 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 this, that. he would take the pressure. No, it was me. I did this. No, it's me, blah, blah, blah. When he should have probably let us take a little bit of the blame as well.
Again, we've had lots of people on that have played under Rafa, they've played under Jared Houllier as well, and they talk about this father figure that you know, furnished you with all the things that you needed, wanted to take away all the pressures off the pitch as well. Is that something that tallies with your experience?
Yeah, 100%. Probably too much at times. He would tell you not to go out shopping, not to do this, not to do that. But you kind of understand. I understand it now as a ex-player and someone who's got kids who are looking to go into that. I understand. Just relax. This is what's going to be the best for you. But when you're in it, you're like, oh, he's been very controlling. But now I understand everything that he was trying to do because he's been that father figure for you.
What was he like in the dressing room, both as a winner but also as a loser?
As a winner, he was fantastic in the sense of getting us up and really making us feel great. Because again, winning is a must in Liverpool. But he was good in that, in the sense of having us enjoy that moment as well, because there is that key bit as well, trying to enjoy that moment, but then moving on because we've got another game. And then in defeatist, like, his thing was, you never lose two games in a row. So we'd always be thinking about the next game in the sense of, what can we do to rectify that? And as well, one, looking at who we've got, and then being sheltering us from... He would take a lot of criticism, so he'd shelter us from taking the criticism so we can be prepared for the next game.
You always come across as a striker that's maybe not weighed down by the expectations of having to score goals. Is that a fair assessment? Some strikers are only about goals, aren't
they? Yeah, and that was the thing. So I never marketed, is that the right word? I never saw myself as just goals.
Yeah.
Yes, I will go and get goals, but I'm not the goal scorer. And that's one thing I even tell my sons as well. If you're not scoring goals, that's fine, but what are you giving me? And there's a lot of players out there who give you loads of goals, but then once that little bit dries up, can you give me something else? And if you can't, what are you then? Are you a burden? Or are you something that is, you know, or are you just a burden to me? And that's where there's a lot of players that I always wanted to be on the ball. I wanted to be an option. I wanted to be not attacking wise. I wanted to be an option in all aspects. So if I have to win a header off the line to save a goal against, I'll do that. If I'm back defending across and I have to defend it and I have to put my head where it hurts, I've got to do that. But if I do it up there as well, I have to do it there as well. That, it wasn't just one end. I wanted to do the lot.
A real team player. 22 goals in the treble winning season. Not bad, eh? What happened that season? You must have enjoyed that.
Yeah. No, that was lovely again. But again, playing with the best players, playing with some players that you just making runs and you're hitting the target, making sure you hit the target, making sure you're troubling the goalkeeper, make sure you're in the box, and that was all I wanted to do. And it wasn't just that; it was the other parts of it: channel runs, chasing back, kicking someone who's kicked my mate, and that was one of the things I loved doing. To be honest, helping other people out as well. But then the goals that came with it was just the bonus on that as well.
So when you talk about playing with the best players, I mean, which players are you talking about? You're talking about running the channels, who provides you with the cross, playing up front with Michael Owen.
Robbie, Jamie Redknapp was there at the time. Diddy was fantastic, Diddy Hammer. But Diddy was good. Diddy has this calming nature. So Diddy would, in just little moments, he'll say, well done, I'm fantastic. I'm like, yeah. And then you go again. He just had this calming nature about him, but he was a fantastic player as well. Paddy Berger and Vladdy were the best in training. You can't get near them. You try and put them on separate teams, because if you put them on both on the same team, it's finished. They're done. But then you have Stefan, you had Sammy, you had Sander, you had Cara, you had Marcus Babbel. You had all these players that were just fantastic players, and you just got to make runs, and you just got to get on the end of things, and that was it, really.
Cara always used to say that team was like playing with your mate. It was as close to being part of a Sunday league team that won everything. in the best sense.
Yeah, in that way, in the sense of the togetherness. I'm not thinking about the way that we played, but yeah, the togetherness, that was, because again, we were like mates. We were together. When it's on the pitch, yeah, we were definitely together. Not letting anyone kick anyone off the park or anything like that. We were, yeah. In fact, I've got your back, you've got mine kind of thing. Yeah, it was like that.
Was there a breakthrough game where you felt, you know, all the things you've talked about there, about homesickness, being a young lad, wanting to live up to that
pressure? Game, the first game of that season, was it Bradford at home? Which was going well in the sense of we were playing well, but we hadn't scored. And then I get the ball and I do what I normally do, which is get the ball and you try and wriggle and turn and run with it. I had the shot and it went in and that was it. And so after that, it was just, euphoria.
What's your main memories of that treble winning the season?
Main memories? Yeah. Just so many games. I think
every 3 days.
Was it 64 that season?
60. I think I played 59 games.
Wow.
And, it was brilliant because I don't think I would change it because, again, you play, you rest, you recover, you play, you rest, you recover. And that's all it was. And I actually enjoyed that part of it. But the only thing is I was disappointed. You get towards the end of the season, you just run out of adrenaline. Yeah, and I can't remember I had to watch back the Alaves game. I can't remember it because it was
a mad game, wasn't it?
It was a crazy game. But I was in the game, but I wasn't in the game because it was just so many games that we played that season. But it's funny that season because, again, coming from where I've come from and I get first full season playoff final. So you go to Wembley, you win that. Then the next season you go to Wembley again, we drew that and then went to the replay and win that. And then two seasons after we go to the Wembley again, we lose that one. The season after we go to Wembley again, win that one. The season after I come here, we win that one again. So it just seems like it's trophies. That's what is norm. That's the norm. And then we win three in one season. Like, oh, okay, this is quite nice. This. And then you go and win the Community Shield. You go and win the Super Cup. And do well with England as well, win 5-1 against Germany. So that season was just, that year in a sense was just mad, absolutely crazy.
You started all three finals as well. You look back on that and think that was some achievement for a lad that, you know, was talked about not so long ago, coming in as a young kid, struggling with all these things. You were a pivotal part of what Houllier was trying to do there.
Yeah, I think the way that Houllier wanted to play, it suited me. I'm not saying it didn't suit Michael or Robbie, but it suited me probably a little bit more, having a focal point. And yeah, I loved it, to be honest with you. Again, I understood what Robbie wanted, I understood what Michael wanted, so I could gel with both of them. It worked. So
you probably were, over the course of your career, a striker's favourite partner, weren't you?
Yeah, because again, I think it's forming a partnership. You're a midfielder, so you form a partnership with your midfielder. And you get an understanding. I wanted to get... Strikers are very selfish. But I wasn't that. I was, what do you want? Okay, let me figure out how I can fit and blend in with you and we'll make this work. Whereas others are like, I don't care what he wants, I'm doing this. Whereas I wasn't like that. I was wanting to work as a partnership. And it's obviously a little bit different now because you only play with one up front. But back then, when you're playing up two up front, it was very important to understand the both of you and what you both wanted.
So you never found it that important. What they could do for you is more what you could do for them.
More what I could do for them. I know what I could do, I'm going to do it. But I want to know what you want to do as well.
But it appears, though, over your career, you and Michael Owen.
Yeah.
Was that your dream partnership?
Yeah, 100%. Started at, like I said, England 18s. I think Michael was 16, 15, 16. And yeah, it just clicked from then straight away, and it was just both understanding what we both different and understanding what we bring to the table, and it just worked so well.
You think of some of the strikers around at that time as well. Obviously, there was talk over, as there always was, Emil's coming in to replace Robbie, but you had Anelka, Litmanen was there at one stage
Yari
as well.
Came. Milan Baros played for a while. So yeah, it was. TT was there when I first came. Yeah. Eric Meyer,
yeah.
Yeah, was there when I first came as well. So it was, but again, there were so many games. It really, for me, it was just about going out there and performing, and I'll show you what I can do, and then we'll take it from there.
you know, we said about the Sunday League partnership there as well. There must have been some good nights out, but the nights out were delayed, weren't they? You couldn't even have a party after the
I think the after the well, we still had one more game after the UEFA Cup, wasn't it?
Charlton.
Robbie scored the over a kick. So it was after that we got to, and then we go away with England again. So it was fascinating because I've come from Leicester where you're not expected to win trophies, to come into here where you're expected to win trophies. I'd come from an environment that you win something, you celebrate.
Yeah.
And you celebrate for... For every cup final that we went to with Martin at Leicester, we were in Tenerife the week before for about six days.
Warm weather training.
Yeah, something like that. But it worked. But then you obviously come to here where it's, you win that game, well, it's done now. Where's the next high? You win that one, it's, well, that's done now. Where's the next one? And you really don't live within the moment.
Mm.
And it's like, you look back now and say, oh, wow, did I do that? Well, how come I didn't actually celebrate it? How come I didn't really feel it while I was in there? No, because that's done.
Is that a regret? Because I sometimes look back and I think, could we have done that differently? Yeah.
No, I don't think it is a regret because again, it drives you. I think.
Yeah.
I think it drives.
Is it
you
that
to have
kind
that
of thing? There has to be a difference between Leicester and Liverpool. It's a big thing at Leicester. It's a bit more expected at Liverpool, maybe.
There's an expectation that you've got to win trophies, and there's an expectation that you've got to win the next game. You've got to win. You've got to win trophies. Okay, we've won that trophy now. That's done. Finished. Move on. Where's the next high? What's the next one? And that's the thing about being elite and being at the top of the tree. It's like you don't celebrate anything really until you finish.
That's driven within the dressing room, though, and that tallies with your time there, doesn't
it? Yeah, absolutely. That's why dressing rooms are so important.
Yeah, 100%.
You know, I mean, the manager closes the door to the dressing room, and then you've got to look after yourself, haven't you?
Yeah, 100%. And that was the main thing. I think we had Karen players like that who were Scousers, so... That fight, they understood. Like when we played Everton, I'd never seen so many local lads so intense. Michael, I'd never seen Michael like. I remember, I think it was a Gary Mack game, where he scored the free kick, and they put a ball in the box, and he goes, and then Michael turned to me and he looked like a possessed man. Mm. So he's just basically saying, just make sure you get your head on this ball, but it's like, don't worry, I'll do it anyway, but you don't need to be so... But it's the intense that they have being local lads.
What made that team not kick on? You know, five trophies within the 12 months, the amount of games that you play. What made the next season, the season after that, not as successful
That's
as you might have?
That's a good question. I'm not sure. I can't tell you for definite. Again, when you bring players in, you would like to think they would give you that elevation. And I'm not blaming any player that didn't give us any elevation, but we were on a high, and I think we just needed one or two players just to make that little transition. And I don't think we got that quite right. And I think that was the main thing, because again, I don't think we're that far off, in my opinion anyway.
October 2001, Leeds United at home. Gerard Houllier is very suddenly taken ill. You're actually receiving treatment at that point in the half-time dressing room, aren't you?
Yeah. I think it was hamstring. Yeah, I think it was my hamstring. So I've come into the physio room. I said, oh, something wrong with my hamstring. Tested it. Yep, it's gone. Blah, blah, blah. Okay, cool. And he comes in as I'm lying there. And he comes in and says, oh, I don't feel too well, doc. Blah, blah, blah. He goes, oh. And so I went to get up. He goes, no, you stay there. I'm like, no, you just lie down. And I got up and went, and then that happened. And I was obviously arguably the last person to see him before that.
That period's really upsetting for players then?
Yeah. Because again, when you talk about a father figure, when someone who's really looked after you and backed you and doesn't let anyone have any negative things to say about you, and then that happens, like, yeah. He was an integral part of... us, and we were a young team. Like I said, I was, 22? Michael's 2 years younger than me, Stevie. Cara's my age. So, yeah, it was a fairly young team.
And how did Tomo keep it going? Because he's a very different character, isn't he?
But different character, really, but well kept, yeah, I think he just kept the same focus and the same messages. So Gerard had a certain way of doing things, and he just kept it. Even with the revealing of the team, the way that the structure was of the meetings, the times of the meetings, everything was kept exactly the same. So the only other thing was Gerard wasn't there. But he kept everything the same.
And him coming back.
That was huge. Was that Roma?
Yeah.
Yeah. That was huge for us. I think we had a little inkling that he possibly could, and then when he actually did, it was just a big, big boost for us as players and as a club, to be honest.
Roma, European nights.
Mm-hmm. Huge.
What were they like?
Yeah, massive.
Generally European
massive,
nights.
Massive, massive. It's weird because, again, when you tell someone they're different, but you can't explain why they're different. You just said the atmosphere is a bit more intense. It's louder. But why? You can't really explain it. But then, yeah, they were.
Try and be on the opposition team.
Yeah, and that was that was the key thing. So one thing that we had with Gerard was, when we went away, just keep it tight, don't concede, and you've done your job. Because when we get back home, they're not going to beat you.
What is your favourite European game at Anfield?
That was one of them because I scored. And the Barcelona where Maka scored.
Yeah, yeah.
Then we had obviously the other Barcelona game where they just popped it around us. But yeah, I think them two games were the best for me.
So many real high points to your Liverpool career. Mm-hmm. Every Liverpool player goes through it. The moment at which the end starts mm-hmm. to become evident. Mm-hmm. What do you remember about that?
I still had one more year left, so it was a case of. I felt ready to fight for another contract or whatever. But then when Rick Parry came to me and said, look, bring in Cisse, we've accepted a deal from Birmingham. So, okay. But I'm ready to fight for my place because I believe in myself. No, he's going to come in and he's going to play. You're like, okay, so you're telling me I'm not playing. Yeah, cool. When someone says that to you, you're kind of like, okay, let me go and have a look at different options. And the Birmingham came in. It was funny because I was actually speaking at one stage. I was speaking to AC Milan and ended up at Birmingham. So no, it's a little bit different. But yeah, it was a good opportunity for I think Steve Bruce at the time came to my house, spoke to me, sold it to me, and it was a good opportunity to go and play.
How do you feel at that moment? Do you look back and you think a bit disappointed it's come to an end so quick, or
yeah. And then they win the European Cup.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's.
But now, you know what? At the time, it was. I never have any regrets in the sense of I went and played and I went and enjoyed football. And that was what it was. And I'm not saying I wasn't enjoying football here. I'm saying that I was told X, Y, and Z. So you've got to kind of react on that. But I probably should have stayed and fought for my place a little bit.
Is that the difference between modern day football and maybe even that era then? Loads of players mention that, don't they? I should have stayed and fought for my place because it's a squad game now and it became a squad game under Rafa, didn't it?
Yeah, it did. And the thing was, I never knew Rafa was coming in. I know we kind of had an inkling that Gerard was leaving as well. And I never knew Rafa was coming. And then I'd already signed for Birmingham and then Rafa came in. It was like, well, that's kind of fits who I am as a striker. So, but again, it is what it is.
Yeah, I don't think it's that easy just to go. I mean, hang around and be part of the squad. You want to play, don't you?
I wanted to play, and it wasn't.
That's your mindset. Yeah, from being a young player. Yeah. You know?
But I was happy to fight as well. But when someone's telling you no, there's no fight, you're not playing, kind of thing. It's like, okay, let's look at something else.
What was it like coming back and playing at Anfield then as an opposition player? You always got a great
reception. Yeah, no, it was always good, and the fans were fantastic to me. It was weird because of the success I had here and always being loved. And that was one of the key things, always being loved here was amazing.
You went to play for Martin O'Neill again a little bit later on. It's kind of etched into the question, but how many of the managers that you played for, being the player that you were, then came back and tried to sign you at different points in your career?
So Martin tried to sign me at Celtic when I was at Liverpool. Just too cold up there. And then obviously when I was at Birmingham, I think he wanted to sign. I said, I can't do that. Then obviously went to Wigan and then came back down to Villa. I think that was it, to be honest with you.
But you were the type of player that managers came back for. He'll do well for
Yeah. Again, the thing for me is I always put 110% in, whether it be training, whether it be games, whatever it is. So they knew what they were getting out of me, and that's one of the key things.
67 caps for England?
62
was it?
Seven goals.
Seven goals? That's not bad, is it?
Yeah.
What are your highlights there then?
The 5-1.
You scored?
Yeah, got the fifth one. And then going to 2 Euros and 2 World Cups. Yeah, it was just a great time. And having my parents watching me and my kids watching me. The only two who haven't watched me is the two youngest girls. And the other two watched me play in 2010. And the older ones watched me play before that. So, yeah, it was just great times.
Do you think there might have been a bit more in it for you in 2002?
Yeah. 100%. I think that was the closest we ever came, and I think, yeah, it was disappointing, but if you're going to lose, you're going to lose to the best.
Yeah, that's a long list of Brazilians.
And that's a key thing. So we had Michael, who's our Ballon d'Or. They had Rivaldo, Ronaldo, Ronaldinho, plus Kaká on the bench. So, yeah, it is a phenomenal team that we played against. But we fought them right to the death. And the thing is, I think Michael was injured in that game, and I didn't even know. He got the goal, and we're like, "Yeah, let's shut up shop. Let's win this game." But we probably scored too early, and then went a little bit probably too negative. But no, it was like I said, playing in the World Cup's fantastic, and playing against the best team at that time was brilliant.
The title of your book was Even Heskey Scored.
Yeah,
is there something subliminal in that? We know the players loved you. We know every manager that signed you loved you, but. Do you ever feel that maybe you weren't appreciated enough across your career for what you achieved?
No, not really. I think people do appreciate it because, again, when people look back, people don't realise that I've been to 2 World Cups and 2 Euros. They don't realise that I've played this many games, scored that many goals. They think, no, you haven't. But when they look now, they're like, oh, OK, appreciate it a little bit more.
I do think, though, however, as a player, I think it's enough that you feel the love and the respect from the people that matters,
yeah,
isn't it?
100%.
The outside noise is whatever, isn't it?
Again, like, the thing for me is I was always picked by the coaches, yeah. And I was always picked by the players. So, like you're saying, they're the ones that matter the most when it comes down to it.
But you were brilliant here. Is that the moment in your career that you go back to and revisit?
Oh, yeah, 100%. Again, when you're winning trophies and you're playing in front of a crowd that is energetic and you're loved in that sense, yeah, 100% come back to that. And it's great when I come back as well, the love you kind of get, even not just here, when I'm travelling anywhere, yeah, bump into Liverpool fans all over the place. I was in the gym this morning and bumped into a Liverpool fan, thank you, bro. So you get all that as well.
We got some quick fires if you wouldn't mind to finish off with. Which is the player, the best player that you've swapped a shirt with?
Xavi.
Nice.
Yeah.
What game is that from?
I think it would have been the Barca one where we won. I think it's that one.
Yeah. Unsung hero of the treble season, who would you pick?
Stephen Henshaw. Well, solid, really solid at the back. Bit rash at times, but but solid at the back. I think they formed a real good partnership and it worked.
A goal from the treble season you wish you'd scored instead of a teammate?
The FA Cup one.
Do you have a favourite Liverpool moment?
Ooh. Do you know what? I'm going to say the FA Cup. Because the FA Cup, for me, as someone growing up in England, that's the game. They're the cup finals that you want to play in. They're the ones you want to win. We got battered in that game, but we won it because of Michael as well. So winning that was just an amazing feeling.
You'd go along with that, wouldn't you? The FA Cup was as big as any
competition. I have the same feelings about the FA Cup. Yeah, that was my favourite moment as well, winning it for the first time. It's just, it is an amazing feeling.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Favourite Liverpool goal?
Ooh. I tell you what, the one at Everton, at Goodison, and the one before Maka scored.
Let's finish with this one. And how do you want Liverpool fans to remember you?
quiet, but fun.
It's funny how you pick two qualities that wouldn't be linked with on the pitch there.
Honest. Yeah. And hardworking.
Yeah. At least, at the very least, all of those qualities. Well, Emile, it's been great catching up with you. Great to see you. We wish you boys and your girls who are promising gymnasts all the best.
Yeah.
And good luck with the taxi driving for the next couple of years. It's great to see you, pal.
Thank you.